The internet is made up of thousands of tiny bits of code that go around the globe on lines as thin as a strand of hair strewn across the ocean floor. In the time it takes you to read one word, the data zips from New York to Sydney, Hong Kong to London. Let's take a look at it. Hey guys, and welcome back to the channel. For this video, we will talk about how the internet travels under the sea and connects the world. But before anything else, please leave a like on the video. Also, don't forget to subscribe to our channel and click the notification bell down below so you won't miss our videos. Without any further ado, let's hop on right to the video. Nearly 750,000 miles of cable already connect the continents to support our insatiable demand for communication and entertainment. Companies have always pooled their resources to work on underwater cable projects, treating it as if it were a road. Google, on the other hand, is going its own way in a first-of-its-kind project that will connect the United States to Chile, where the company's largest data center in Latin America is located. People think that data is in the cloud, but it's not, said Jane Stowell, who oversees the construction of Google's undersea cable projects. It's in the ocean. It takes a long time and a lot of effort to get it there. The cable will be delivered by sea by a 456-foot ship named Durable. But first, the cable is built in a large factory in Newington, New Hampshire, just a few hundred yards away. The factory, which is operated by Subcom, is equipped with specialized machinery for maintaining wire tension and encasing it in a protective skin. The cable starts out as a cluster of strands of small glass fiber threads. Using fiber optic technology, lasers push data down the threads to nearly the speed of light. The data required to read an email or across a web page is downloaded into a person's device after they arrive on land and connect to an existing network. While most of us now access the internet primarily through Wi-Fi and mobile data plans, these systems eventually connect to real cables that quickly transport data across countries or oceans. The wires are wrapped in a copper jacket that transports energy across the line to keep the data going during the production process, which involves high-speed mills the size of jet engines. Plastic, steel, and tar are added afterward depending on where the cable will be installed to help it endure the varied ocean circumstances. The cable will be the size of a thick garden hose when finished. A year of planning goes into plotting a cable route that minimizes underwater risks, yet the lines must still endure strong currents, rock falls, earthquakes, and fishing trawler interference. Each cable should survive for up to 25 years. The cable is moved directly into Durable, which is docked on the Piscataqua River by a conveyor dubbed the Cable Highway by workers. When completely loaded, the ship will transport over 4,000 miles of cable weighing around 3,500 metric tons. Workers spool the cable into enormous tanks inside the ship. One person walks the cable quickly in a circle as if laying out a large garden hose, while others lie down to keep it in place and prevent it from snagging or knotting. Even with workers working around the clock, it takes roughly 4 weeks for the ship to be fully loaded with the cable and ready to go. In 1858, the first transatlantic cable was built, connecting the United States and the United Kingdom. Queen Victoria honored the event by sending a 16-hour message to President James Buchanan. In the decades following, new wireless and satellite technologies have been developed, but cables remain the quickest, most efficient, and least expensive route to transport data over the ocean. And it's still not cheap. Google wouldn't reveal how much the project cost Chile, but experts estimated that subsea cable projects can cost up to $350 million, depending on the length. Telecommunications corporations laid the majority of the cable in the modern age, but during the last decade, American tech behemoths have begun to exert increasing authority. At least 14 cables have received Google's support around the world, according to Telegeography, a research organization. Amazon, Facebook, and Microsoft have invested in others connecting data centers across North America, South America, Asia, Europe, and Africa. Countries regard submarine cables as important infrastructure, and the projects have sparked geopolitical tensions. Last year, Australia intervened to prevent Huawei, a Chinese technology company, from constructing a connection connecting Australia and the Solomon Islands, fearing that it would give the Chinese government access to its networks. One of the ship captain, Yan Duryu's most essential jobs, he added, was maintaining morale among his crew over the weeks at sea. It takes a lot of time and effort to build the infrastructure of our digital world. The Durable can accommodate up to 80 crew members with 53 bedrooms and 60 baths. Two 12-hour shifts are scheduled for the team. There are signs in the hallways warning people to remain quiet because someone is usually sleeping. The ship will be stocked with enough food to last at least 60 days, including 200 loaves of bread, 100 gallons of milk, 500 dozen eggs each carton, 800 pounds of meat, 1,200 pounds of chicken, and 1,800 pounds of rice. There are also 300 paper towels, 500 toilet paper rolls, 700 soap bars, and nearly 600 pounds of laundry detergent. Alcohol is not permitted on board. "I still get seasick," said Walt Oswald, a technician who has been laying cables on ships for 20 years. He sticks a small patch behind his ear to hold back nausea. It's not for everybody. It's impossible to avoid bad weather. Swells can reach 20 feet, forcing the ship captain to request the undersea cable to be cut in order for the ship to navigate to safer seas. The ship returns when the weather improves, retrieving the cut cable that was left attached to a floating buoy and sewing it back together before proceeding. The work on board is sluggish and tedious. The ship, which is at sea for months at a time, moves at around 6 miles per hour while the cables from the massive basins are dragged out via ports in the ship's back. An underwater plow is used to bury the cable in the seafloor closer to the shore, where there is a higher risk of damage. The business already operates 13 data centers across the world, with 8 more under development, all of which are required to support the trillions of Google searches performed each year and the more than 400 hours of video uploaded to YouTube every minute. "It really is the management of a very complex multi-dimensional chessboard," said Mrs. Stowell of Google, who wears an undersea cable as a necklace. As more organizations rely on cloud computing services, the need for subsea connections will only increase. And next technology, such as more powerful artificial intelligence and autonomous automobiles, will all necessitate rapid data speeds. Areas that previously lacked internet access are suddenly gaining it, with the UN announcing that for the first time, more than half of the world's population has access to the internet. "This is a huge part of the infrastructure that's making that happen," said Debbie Brask, the vice president at Subcom, who is managing the Google project. "All of that data is going to the undersea cables." Current providers such as Google, Facebook, Microsoft, and Amazon have begun laying additional underwater cables in recent years to improve network access. Google and Facebook recently revealed plans for 2 new undersea data cables connecting North America and Asia Pacific. After they interrupted a cable bound for Hong Kong, they made this announcement. To expand trans-Pacific capacity, Facebook and other partners will invest in the Echo and Bifrost cables, which will connect Singapore, Indonesia, and North America, doubling trans-Pacific capacity by 70%. The first trans-Pacific cables to span the Java Sea will be the Bifrost and Echo, and their construction will roughly triple capacity. In Indonesia, Google will work with Telen and XL Axiata, and in Singapore, Google will also work with Capel. It will only be a matter of time before we witness high-speed continuous internet services as additional fiber optic undersea cables are built around the world. We want to hear your thoughts on this. What do you think of how the internet works under the ocean? Let us know in the comments section below. That's it for today. If you guys enjoyed the video, make sure to hit the like button, don't forget to subscribe, and turn on that notification bell so you never miss out on any future content we'll produce for you guys. We're signing off now, but we'll be sure to catch you all in the next one.